associate professor in the School of Art, and I'm thrilled to be facilitating this event in celebration of the release of the Cyberfeminism Index. Woo! Before I introduce our esteemed guest, I want to express gratitude to the Frank-Ratchye Studio for Creative Inquiry and all of the incredible staff there for supporting this event as part of their Sylvia and David Steiner lecture series. This event would additionally not be possible without the support of the Carnegie Mellon School of Art, so thank you all. Today we're going to hear from Mindy Sue, who will introduce us to their practice, as well as their massive undertaking, the Cyberfeminism Index. We'll additionally hear from Kyla Willis, an artist, groundbreaking member of the Cyberfeminist Collective Subversa, and educator based here in Pittsburgh, whose work is also represented in the index. After their respective presentations, we'll shift into an intergenerational panel about cyberfeminism. I'll moderate a conversation between Mindy and Kyla, and then we'll open it up to audience questions. This event will have to move pretty quickly and keep on time because Mindy has to catch a flight directly afterwards. So don't be alarmed when I'm just like, it's over, done, she's running out the door. So I'm gonna go ahead and introduce our first speaker of the evening, and then when our second speaker is up, I'll introduce her as well. So, Mindy Sue is a designer and technologist based in New York City. Her expanded practice involves archival projects, technocritical writing, performative lectures, design commissions, sharing and close collaborations. Mindy's ongoing Cyberfeminism Index, which I'm gonna say so many times this evening, gathers 3 decades of online activism and net art, was commissioned by Rhizome and presented at the New Museum among many other cultural institutions. She's additionally presented at institutions including the Barbican Center, Columbia University and Central St. Martin's, as well as mainstream platforms like Pornhub, Google, and the Internet Archive. Mindy is currently assistant professor at Rutgers and critic at Yale School of Art. I'm deeply thankful for the work that she's been doing to tell complex, critical, and hard-to-find stories of intersectional feminist activism across time and online. Founder of Furtherfield, Ruth Catlow thoughtfully writes the following about Mindy's project. The Cyberfeminism Index celebrates, troubles, and critiques the histories and futures of struggle against networked patriarchy, from its first libidinous eruptions to tenacious tactical disruptions and mutations. For theorists and hegemony hackers alike, the index offers an inspirational and educational resource for the urgent work of glitching and decolonizing intersectional internets now. For me, as someone whose practice has also been included in this incredible tome, it's been deeply meaningful to see the work that Mindy has done to bring visibility to this discourse that has not been historically prioritized by commercial art institutions. It's an absolute honor and a privilege to be able to introduce you to Mindy Sue. And now we clap.
Hi, everyone. Let me reshuffle some things. Thank you so much for being here. As mentioned earlier, it's my first time in Pittsburgh, and so nice for this to be my first introduction. I'm gonna quickly run through this project, the Cyberfeminism Index, and then, as Angela mentioned, so excited to talk with Kyla Willis about Sub Rosa and their projects over the past couple decades. So this book, the Cyberfeminism Index, is a source book. It's a chronology that's annotated, and it's also a collection of online activism and net art from the past 3 decades, structured as an index of indexes. And I'll walk you through what that means a bit later. But before we jump there, we might ask, what is cyberfeminism? So there are a lot of different definitions of this word, but if you were to ask me, I would start by breaking apart this word itself. So the prefix cyber first emerged in Norbert Wiener's cybernetics of the 1940s. I'm sure people here are familiar with this field of study. But in the most simple one-liner, cybernetics proposes that not only are you impacting a system, that system is also impacting you. So you're in this feedback loop of change, of inputs and outputs. Cyber was then fixed to space to become cyberspace in William Gibson's Neuromancer of the 1980s. I'm sure people have read this science fiction novel as well. So Gibson's cyberspace was important for a lot of reasons. It kind of predicted these sensory networked online landscapes that are very much in conversation today. Think the metaverse and virtual realities. But Gibson's cyberspace was also very much characterized by the male gaze. So you have fembots and cyberbabes and depictions of women in robotic or assistant-like roles. So when cyber was fixed to feminism, this was done by two distinct parties, unbeknownst to the other. The first was the Australian art collective VNS Matrix, and the second was the British cultural theorist Sadie Plant. By bringing together these seemingly disparate word parts, it was almost seen as a provocation or an oxymoron. How could feminists or women or marginalized communities shape what cyberspace might be? And we see a lot of examples throughout this book that are techno-utopic to dystopic and everything in between. The sticker itself comes from the website of the Old Boys Network. So the Old Boys Network is one of the first international cyberfeminist collectives or alliances. The sticker comes from the webpage of Helene von Oldenburg, in which she asked the public about their opinion of what cyberfeminism was. And here, as you can see in this pie chart, it was met with a lot of confusion and a lot of different answers. Instead of creating a clarifying definition, during the first Cyberfeminist International in 1997, they instead co-wrote the 100 Antitheses, which listed 100 poetic, playful, and multilingual definitions as to what cyberfeminism was not, rather than what it was, in the attempts to be more inclusive and adaptable. This book is also the edited hard copy of a soft copy called cyberfeminismindex.com. So this website was first commissioned by Rhizome in 2020, co-created with Angeline Meitzler with support from Janine Rosen and Charles Braskoski. But this website is almost trying to act like a living archive. If we have time, I'll talk about this a little bit more later. But essentially, while we have this idea that websites are ephemeral, mutable, and perhaps less legitimate than something like a book, in this case, we're trying to flip that on its head. The book almost acts like a snapshot of a moment of the website's mutation. So even since we froze the website to create this manuscript, 300 additional entries have been added to the index. So as you click through the website, if you're unable to find a printed copy of this book, you could, in theory, select your own entries and then download your own PDF. So if you have any entries of your own work, of your peers, or historical references, please feel free to submit, because we'll be crowdsourcing, hopefully, in perpetuity. This website is also an interface filled with hyperlinks. When we think about hyperlinks, they tend to have a digital connotation. But historically, the origins of the hyperlink were very much inspired by the analog. Think of indexes, bibliographies, footnotes, other forms of citations. So even in entry 146, Cyberfeminism, Connectivity, Critique, and Creativity by Renata Klein and Susan Hawthorne from 1999. In their editor's note, they actually call their cross-references a hypertextual link. And then throughout the book's pages, in the margins, you have an eye icon that pushes and pulls you to different parts of the book with juxtaposed or nonlinear themes. It's really trying to encourage a form of nonlinear reading or surfing a book, you might say. In each of these excerpts, you'll see these green pills. So if you were to follow a path of these pills in this book, that might read something like this. Cyberfeminism is a mutating word with a nebulous history. Its evolution is less a single root system with multiple branches than a network of entangled rhizomes, constantly and multidirectionally moving. Virginia Barrett of the Australian art collective VNS Matrix has described cyberfeminism as anti-genealogical, anti-authorial, and a hostile mucus, never faithful to any origins. Cross-reference 8. VNS Matrix, 1991. The most consistent VNS Matrix genesis story is that VNS Matrix crawled out of the cyber swamp in the particularly hot summer of 1991, and via an aesthetics of slime initially generated as porn by women for women. VNS Matrix forged an unholy alliance with technology and its machines and spewed forth a blasphemous text which was the birth of cyberfeminism. VNS Matrix was on a mission to hijack the toys from techno cowboys and remap cyberculture with a feminist bent. This is one story. There are also stories about a slime consciousness operating via spiral space. Cross-reference 181. Tales from the Puppet Mistress, Gash Girl, 2000. Years after losing my machine virginity to a Mac 512K, I have slipped through the reality grid into the clear, violent haze of spiral space. Desire. I slide through the luminous screen to inhabit the spaces between words. The keyboard is constantly sticky. Madness. An erotically reconstructed replicant, my biocode is being rewritten. This is better than any drug. Cross-reference 646. Disquartizadora, Ripper. Mestiza of the Southern Pussy, meat of a pussy that expels word vomit, conserved by death and disgust of the colonization representing an ancestral systemic violation in live meat. I do not feel pride because I was born full of prejudices. No Man's Land, cross-reference 95. Confessions of a Webback, Guillermo Gomez Pena with Evan Thea Shipstead, 1997. You call yourself a webback. Do you see yourself as an intruder on the net? Yes. The number of Latino students, artists, and activists on the net is minute. But we want to participate in the national and cultural debates, and many are permeated by technology. I consider myself a coyote, a smuggler of ideas. We want net inhabitants to get used to a new cultural sensibility, but we do encounter the linguistic border patrol. So what you're seeing here is essentially the primary index. It feels kind of like an encyclopedia, and similar to reading an encyclopedia, you likely wouldn't do that cover to cover. You might open the book at random, find an entry that resonates with you, build associations on the page, or in this book, you could move to different parts using these cross-references. These hyperlinks essentially serve as my personal learning trail, but of course, you can create your own. If you want more of a guided tour, there's also collections of where we invited artists, activists, scholars, and collectives to create a collection on a theme and select 10 to 20 entries from this book on that theme. So for example, we have Skawanadi, who's considered one of the first indigenous net artists, who created a theme called Indigenous Futurism, and then this is Skawanadi's trail. If you have something specific in mind, there's also the index of titles, as well as an index of people. But if you're looking for more serendipitous discovery, there's also the index of images. All New Gen, VNS Matrix, 1992. sabotage the databanks of Big Daddy Mainframe. Your guides through the contested zone are renegade DNA sluts. The most wicked is Circuit Boy, a dangerous techno bimbo. Be prepared to question your gendered construction. Genital Panic, Mary Magic, 2020. We must reconsider the normative body and how disobedient bodies are already pathologized. From the medicalization of infants born of ambiguous genitalia to the disqualification of intersex athletes on the basis of biology, these guidelines matter. They determine how we are policed and how we are surveilled. The Black Trans Archive, Danielle Brathwaite Shirley, 2020. Welcome to the pro-Black, pro-trans archive. This interactive archive was made to store and center Black trans people, to preserve our experiences, our thoughts, our feelings, our lives, to remember us even when we are at risk of being erased. So in order to enter this archive, you have three options. The first is if you're Black and trans. The second is if you're trans, and the third is if you're cis. And depending on your selection, you would have access to a different body of content inside this online space. Time Traveler TM, Scawinati, 2008. This is a website from the future. Watch for upcoming episodes in which Hunter Deerhouse sails to Europe with Pocahontas in AD 1615, aids and abets the Dakota Sioux Uprising of 1862, and finds true love in the Kahnawake Mohawk Territory in 2009. So what you're seeing here is a machinima. A machinima is a portmanteau of machine and cinema. These were plays or films that took place within video games and then ended up the recording as video art pieces. And you can watch all six episodes of Scawinati's Time Traveler on their website. The Bitch Mutant Manifesto, VNS Matrix, 1996. Your fingers probe my neural network. The tingling sensation in the tips of your fingers are my synapses responding to your touch. It's not chemistry, it's electric. Don't ever stop fingering my separating holes, extending my oozing boundary. But in spiral space, there is no they, there is only us. Suck my code. Daddy Residency, Nahi Kim, 2019. I plan to have a baby after 7 years by artificial insemination, and I'd like to have a variety of companions for that rigorous but invaluable parenting experience. So I'm launching this open call for daddy residents for people who want to raise the baby with me for a certain amount of time. The application deadline is July 31st, 2025. So you all have less than 2 years to apply to be Nahi's baby daddy. Okay, last but not least, the Old Boys Network, 1997. The Old Boys Network is regarded as the first international cyberfeminist alliance. Normally, the term Old Boys Network is used as a metaphor to describe an informal interrelation of men. Nowadays, Old Boys Network may be used for a dangerous cyberfeminist virus. So I wanted to quickly close with the acknowledgments. This is a title sequence typically reserved for the ends of films or video art pieces. But it goes to show the huge number of people that go into making projects like these possible. Books are essentially examples of world building. And so this gives credit to the people who've worked on the content, like the Front Men Back Matter, Forward Afterward collections. When I was first creating this index, it started with phone calls of people who then referred me to others, and those are all listed here under referred by. The submitted by are all of the people who submitted entries to cyberfeminismindex.com at the time this manuscript was frozen. So there are many more people who've submitted since then, and one of those people could be you. People have asked, if this is a co-authored volume, then why is my name on the cover? And this is something that my collaborator Laura Combs and I talked about quite a bit as we are doing some material research into similar types of books. When you see compendiums or textbooks, the byline is often invisible or very, very small. And what that might suggest is the document that you're looking at is almost projected as a singular or objective truth. By featuring an authoring editor, it hopefully suggests that the volume that you're looking at is one collected by a very subjective bias. So while this book is co-authored, the rules of moderation for this particular definition of cyberfeminism was very much moderated by myself and various stewards. So it's not to give someone to celebrate, it's to give someone to blame, and blame they have, because if there is a problem in this book or on the website, I'm kind of the one that does the fire drills, and I welcome them. I want people to push back and say, I don't actually think I identify as this, or I really think I do. Can you actually tweak this definition a bit? So all that said, I think the best part about this kind of project is that while this is an example of material gathering, bringing together all of these disparate elements into a container, it's also allowed for a lot of social gatherings, like ones that we're in now. So I once again really give my thanks to Angela Washko, and I'm so excited to be in discussion with Hyla Willis. And I'm gonna quickly switch off the screen so we can welcome Hyla onto the stage. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Mindy. Let's give Mindy another round of applause. That's amazing. So I'm going to introduce Hyla Willis. Hyla is an interdisciplinary artist, graphic designer, and co-founder of the cyberfeminist art collective Sub Rosa, which has focused on the ways women are impacted by rapidly evolving biological and communication technologies. Willis has performed, exhibited, and given workshops in Europe, Asia, Australia, and throughout North America. She holds an MFA from Carnegie Mellon University, here. Yay. And has been the recipient of 2 Pennsylvania Council on the Arts Fellowships in New Genres, a Creative Capital Grant in Emerging Fields, a McDowell Colony Fellowship in Interdisciplinary Arts, and an Artist Opportunity Grant from the Greater Pittsburgh Arts Council. She's Professor of Media Arts at Robert Morris University. Please join me in welcoming Hyla Willis, whose collective work is represented in the Cyberfeminist Index many times.
Hi, everybody. I can't see a darn thing in the audience. Woo. All right, as the slide says, I'm going to take you on a whirlwind tour through just a tiny, tiny bit of Sub Rosa's collective practice. So I'm up here representing a lot of people, but I want to give you just a little bit of context, because Sub Rosa was actually founded in this very building when Faith Wilding was a visiting artist and had a little grant from the Studio for Creative Inquiry. So a little bit more context, especially for the students in the audience. 1998 was kind of a crucible. You might call it the web 1.0 years. And we started as a reading group thinking about women and technology and how could we sort of expand that idea. At the same time, we were starting to hear about cyberfeminism through Faith, who had actually been to Europe and met the Old Boys Network. Does the tartan still exist? Is the tartan still around? So they had all these ads at the time soliciting young women to be egg donors for this fairly new procedure, in vitro fertilization. So all of this kind of like started to coalesce for us into some of our early themes. One of our first projects was a website called Smart Mom. And this was when you would just make a website, put it online, and it was a piece of net art. Smart Mom was very much inspired by some of the battlefield technology being developed at University of Georgia. And we were sort of doing a dystopian take on what happens when they start to wrap this around gestating women. A further expansion of some of our themes, we were really looking at how women produce and reproduce labor, sex work, comfort, cells, data processing, repetitive labor, childcare, elder care. We give up our bodies in whole and in part while being continually surveilled. We're the perfect fodder for surveillance capitalism. We were humorously inspired by a gigantic doll that used to live in the basement of the Pittsburgh Children's Museum. And we made this anatomical female genitalia that you could sort of reconfigure. This was during a time when it was becoming popular to have plastic surgery on your vulva, which we thought was kind of interesting and strange. Flash forward, we were invited to this amazing show at Mass MoCA, which is a huge museum in Massachusetts, which used to be a textile printing mill. So we decided that we would accept this invitation if we could intervene in the place. And so we started to research the building that the museum exists in, and we found that it used to be a capacitor winding factory that mostly employed women, and that the factory during NAFTA had moved all its labor to Ciudad Juarez in a sort of inversion of the same economic practices that brought a lot of Canadian women down into the States to work. The women in Ciudad were being killed, probably still are. So on the back wall here, you see posters about that addressed by Mexican graphic designers. And we built a forensic floor. The audience could lift up pieces and kind of discover the connected histories between the two places. At the top here, you see actual people working in the museum before it became the museum. Most of our projects involve a lot of background research, and sometimes they involve connecting with communities in different ways. And so we often always do a sort of expanded bibliography to share some of our thinking and research. And so in this case, we did a giant map, which is also a book, and which talks about North Adams, Massachusetts on one side and Ciudad Juarez on the other, and is also supposed to kind of be a map without actually being a map. So the size and the folds are all very specific. And I have a bunch of these if you want one after we're all done. Mapping has been kind of a theme and a way of engaging for other projects as well. So this is a project that was about the global, kind of the transnational trade in body parts, such as this organ cartel reported by the New York Times a while ago. And so we would kind of do a performative lecture talking about this trade, and then ask the audience for, like, have they encountered this sort of global economics in any way personally? And then they would contribute stories and also ideas about how it could be done differently, and we would apply them to the map. And oh my gosh, we did this project in Mexico twice, and boy, did we learn a lot each time from our audience. Similar in structure, but different in content, this was a residency in Zagreb, where we found that the younger generation had not talked at all with the older generation, and vice versa, about the experiences of the Balkan Wars, which really were harsh on women. As well, there was a center for women's studies that was not allowed to be part of the University of Zagreb University, a university that has been in continuous operation since the 1600s and is a little bit set in its ways. So since then, so graduate students would go off campus to use their library and whatnot. So we learned all this stuff, we connected a bunch of people, and now I think that that center is part of the university, and we met some really cool young people and tried to elevate and expand their voices and their concerns beyond the scope of the project. We were in Zagreb for a couple weeks for that. More recently, and this I think is the last one, currently, in recent years, so Rosa has mostly been Faith Welding and I with occasional other collaborators. And we have lived in different cities for a very long time. So we hunker down somewhere in the world and plan out our projects. And then we kind of work remotely until it's showtime. This project was spawned at a remote lake in Vermont. And we started to think about cyber swamp escapees. So it was really cool to see that phrase come, the cyber swamp phrase come up in Mindy's reading. So we made these kind of goofy costumes. It was partly in response to a show called Ministry of Hacking. And we wanted to ask the question, thinking of a server as a kind of metaphor, what would a feminist server be? So that was kind of our, and also we were thinking about all the self-management, self-improvement stuff out there and how much of it came actually out of Silicon Valley office worker culture. And we wanted to kind of critique it, kind of the self-optimization. It's this weird mix of like Silicon Valley and like new age stuff. So that's this project. And we have the good fortune of sometimes we have access to translators, but also Faith speaks three languages, and that has come in very handy when we're traveling. This was done in Graz, and there are a lot of Nigerian immigrants there, so I could chat in English with them. But we just sort of integrated into the town, asked people questions about their experiences with technology, and then invited them back to the gallery to kind of contribute more conversation and to a map. It was astonishingly less phone connected the time we were there. The kids weren't carrying phones, or were like, don't you have cell phones? And they pulled them out of their pocket, but they weren't glued to them. It was very interesting. Here's a common scenario today where you cannot live without your phone. So I think this is it. I'll end with this slide, which was a just a really different kind of performance. This was a collaboration with Wu Sang. It was about, it was commissioned for a show about intersex and the two-gendered system as being a kind of human rights violation. So we did this very poetic piece around that. That's it. There's a ton more to explore, but time is short. So thank you for your attention, and I'll turn it back.
So to start us off, the Cyberfeminism Index is described by Inventory Press as both a vital introduction for those unfamiliar and a robust resource guide for educators in the field. Cyberfeminism Index, an anti-canon of sorts, celebrates the multiplicity of practices that fall under this imperfect categorization and makes visible cyberfeminism's long-ignored origins and expansive legacy. So I wanted to talk a little bit about this complicated and difficult task of taking on, sort of creating this slippery history of cyberfeminism, especially given how many platforms shut down, how many mailing lists no longer exist, the ephemeral nature of information sharing and actions distributed online, and of course the challenge of what makes it into the index, what's represented, and at any given time what might still be left out. So for Mindy, I'm wondering if you can talk about your approach and process, sort of where are you looking? You know, we've learned a lot about that from your presentation, but if you could expand on, is it possible to be inclusive and comprehensive while also being rigorous and critical as well. And I have a follow-up for Hyla.
So I think it's important to explain, when I say cyberfeminism is an imperfect umbrella term, it's because when I was trying to find all of these examples in other regions, I found that there were different terms. So if I searched Korean cyberfeminism, I actually wouldn't find as much until I talked to some scholars in that space who said, oh, the Korean term for cyberfeminism is netfemi. And same with Mexico City or Latin America, they use hack feminista. And of course, we have all of these contemporary terms too, like Legacy Russell's glitch feminism, Laborio Kubanik's xenofeminism, feminist Afrofuturism, the list goes on and on. So I think we were trying to honor these new taxonomies that were emerging, but because there were such clear through lines between them, show how similar they were, even if they weren't all saying the same thing. I don't think we're trying to say all cyber feminists think the same, but rather that they have like a same mission and push against the same kind of thing. In terms of moderation, for me, it was really going back to the cybernetic origins of this feedback loop. So you have not only a criticality of technology, you're disseminating feminism through online channels, but you have to be critical of tech through its use. So an example of one hashtag feminism movement that was added was hashtag Me Too. So that's not on the website and that's not in the book, because in my eyes, it became so broad that it was no longer about a critical use and critique of technology. Whereas maybe a different hashtag feminism movement like hashtag Gamergate is in the book and on the website because it was able to have those two points. So again, it's not a perfect model. There have been different pushbacks from different regions across time, but for the most part, it does help bring in this technical critical edge throughout all of the entries you'll see throughout the book.
The term when I was coming up in the sort of net art digital feminism community was digifeminism, and it was like, it lasted for like a whole year and then moved on. But yeah, and for those of you who might not be familiar with the term hashtag Gamergate, Gamergate was an anti-feminist hate movement online that a lot of the artists and activists featured in the Cyberfeminism Index, including myself, were targets of. So Hyla, I would love to hear about Sub Rosa and how you all were thinking about archiving your actions given the sort of fleeting and shifting nature of internet infrastructure. I mean, maybe it was hard to forecast how much the internet would change from web 1.0 to 2.0 to 3.0. Were you thinking about, the future of, Sub Rosa's archive at the time that you were active? I guess I'm also thinking about, with my project, the Council on Gender Sensitivity and Behavioral Awareness in World of Warcraft, I was borrowing strategies from culture jammers and tactical media artists and kind of strategically using mainstream media and getting journalists to cover these actions that were taking place in online platforms because the conversations were ephemeral. There were perfectly good reasons why those conversations had to disappear after a certain amount of time. I'm curious about what some of your approach to archiving in this sort of ephemeral territory of the net was like.
It's a good question because it's definitely resource and time intensive because it's like continual, like disposable knowledge. So I think at first we were just sort of struggling to keep up. Like I had a little bit of an advantage learning code because I was a typesetter. But then like things would expire. Like I remember learning director like over and over again and it went away and like those pieces became void. And then seeing, I believe it was the Getty had this massive video art retrospective, like the whole history of video art. And it was just so incredibly challenging to preserve all those formats. So we didn't think a whole lot about it other than like always having publications as well. And trying to keep the web code pretty simple, although we have a bunch of flash sites that have expired that we haven't figured out what to do with. So I would say our strategy has been to always have paper backups and then to just continually scramble to try to stay on the web, but it's challenging.
Of course.
So I think something that, as you're saying, thinking about what the different translation of the work are was also really interesting when creating this index, because there's a reason why we call it an index and not an archive. So in many ways, an archive gathers things together, and capital A archive tends to have methods of generational preservation in place. An index is actually pointing outwards. So everything you're seeing on the site and everything in the book is just an excerpt. Nothing is in its whole form, unless it's like a manifesto or rather short. But that means what we try to do is fortify the link out. So if a website is down, we'll make sure that we add the link to a website emulator like Wayback Machine or Rhizomes Conifer. If there's a PDF, we will download it from JSTOR and host it in multiple places and add multiple links. So I think what we are trying to do is fortify that outward movement. So it's, I think this is also what makes it a bit anti-canonical, because we're trying to keep it as permeable and porous as possible.
Awesome, thank you for that. I'm curious, and you talked a little bit about the reason why you're using cyberfeminism as a sort of framework or terminology, but I'm very curious about the sort of reintroduction of it as a term to a new generation. Because for me at least, cyberfeminism has a very specific link to practices that emerged within the early Web 1.0 internet. Practices that respond very specifically to the very possibilities of network life and new computing culture. Some of the artists and activists that you mentioned, Venus Matrix, Skawanadi's Abtech, Aboriginal Territories in Cyberspace, which if you're not familiar, you should definitely look them up, and they're in the index. But yeah, I think for me it has this very historical context connected to it, linked to this specific time frame and set of politics and practices. And things have shifted. So in whatever order the two of you want to go in, for Mindy, my question is, what was your thinking around reintroducing this term? Are you reclaiming it? And then applying it to this maybe broader set of feminist practices over time, including the feminist moment, or sorry, including the present moment. And then for Hyla, I'd be curious to hear you talk about how you've seen cyberfeminism shift and change since the start of Sub Rosa. So in whatever order you want.
Had we had access to the index, we probably wouldn't have had so many arguments about whether we wanted to actually call ourselves cyberfeminist or not. And because ultimately we decided, yes, we're gonna grab what we think is this buzzword because we wished to expand it, because we thought at the time what we had access to, so access is a huge question, we had access to those who could disseminate their work, and we didn't have access to those who could not. So we had a lot of questions about privilege, about race, about nationality, different forms of literacy, who could participate in this cyberfeminism, and who did it address, and who was it for. So we had many influences. I'll just shout out Lisa Nakamura's book, Cyber Types, as really saying like, oh, all these women are so excited to go on the internet because they can be free of gender, so why do they all become this like one type of thing? So.
Oh, and race in cyberspace, also Lisa Nakamura, dealing with a lot of those issues as well. Really great book, but go ahead.
Yeah, I mean, Lisa Nakamura, Radhika Gajala, Maria Fernandez, there are all these incredible people also working in the 90s and early aughts. So if you talk to people like Judy Wiseman or Sadie Plant, they will tell you the name of the book is bad, and they've told me this. They say it should be techno-feminism, which is fair. Some people like Cornelis Solfrank actually appreciate the term cyberfeminism because it shows that it's a revisionist internet history. So it points back to the origins while also showing how it's constantly mutating. So Cornelia says that cyberfeminism has moved towards ecology and economy, right? So these are things like sex workers pushing forward cryptocurrencies, things moving outside the browser and understanding the material repercussions of internet infrastructure. All of these things might still qualify as cyberfeminist, even if it's no longer browser-based or NetArt-based. So that said, I don't know if there's a clear answer. I liked it because it pointed to a clear lineage, but I do think that there's a lot of pushback in definition because these terms are inherently exclusionary. Which is why we try to use it almost like an asterisk at the end. Like, we're calling it cyberfeminism, but a lot of people identify as many different things, and we're just trying to show the similarities or clear critiques in between them.
I really appreciate that. So my next question has to be really fast, because I want to make sure we have some time to hear from the audience, and I know that you have to run immediately after. I guess my last question is for both of you, what are your hopes for the future of cyberfeminism, and where do you see the movement headed? Big, you know, just the easy questions for you now.
I think it's really exciting because you were never really able to predict where the movement might lead because there was no core, right? It was a very, very rhizomatic thing. So as the internet was being adopted in different countries at different times, as different cultural moments were happening, you would see these constant mutations. And I think Shuli Chang says that cyberfeminism should be tagged like variants similar to COVID, so you can see kind of this branching structure of its virality without having to point to an original root. So something like this I think is nice, but that said, I like the open-ended question of not being able to predict where it will go, and hopefully that's something that all of you will take as a call to action, because I do think even now when I see some of my Gen Z students using the internet, creating these micro internet communities, like that I do think falls into this camp.
For sure.
So the last couple summers I attended the Figma conference. That's this giant piece of, I don't know, software thing that Adobe bought for $2 billion. Anyway, their young software engineers were super duper interested in the early internet culture. More than the aesthetics, like what were people thinking when they were working on the internet? That gave me so much hope. And I just think we really need all different kinds of feminism, including feminism that guys bring to the table in the software industry and in determining like who owns our faces with all this AI database. Like we need you to help these tech giants think this through. And so that's my hope.
Hold them accountable. Just really quick before I open it up to the audience, our library has purchased copies of the Cyberfeminism Index, so you can see it there, but where else can our audience find this incredible tome?
It is available in most online booksellers. I would discourage you from using Amazon because you can find it all over bookshop from independent booksellers. I'm sure there are bookstores in Pittsburgh that have it, or you can order directly from inventorypress.com, but yeah, pretty easy to find.
Let's raise the lights and we'll shift to audience questions. Can we give our amazing guests a hand before we do that? All right, who has questions? There's two in the back. You can decide amongst yourselves who wants to go first. Get the book, sorry. had to do it. Just kidding, go ahead.
I mean, I do think the book is a good resource for this. There are many other collections of cyberfeminism, even if they don't use that name. So a lot of, if you go to like a critical media theory section of the bookstore, or even look at online movements and some of the things that they're citing, they will likely be citing material, projects, theory or practice that are about a critical use of tech and its infrastructure, as well as how do we kind of push feminism or similar themes to different audiences. So I don't think it necessarily has to be a particular thing, and I would hope there's no original root. But if anything, I think that as we're kind of leaning into certain terms that we want to identify with, whether it's feminist or womanist or et cetera, you kind of have to create your own lineage so you can really back up and fortify what those beliefs are, because everyone's definition is pretty different.
Do you want to mention domain errors?
Yeah,
You can get domain, or you can download that actually. Get this index because, and get the paper copy, because here's the brilliance of a book. No one knows what page you're looking at, for how long, or which page you turn to next. The internet probably knows that you got the book from your library or bookstore, but they don't know what you're doing once you crack the pages open. And that is beautiful. And the way this is set up, you can just flip it open and go, yep, nope. And if it's a yep, then look at the little bubble numbers and follow the trail. It will expand a whole world. You'll find stuff you like, you don't like. I would get the book.
Thank you.
I don't get a commission.
Yeah. And there was another question in the back.
Yeah, so, I mean, maybe I can answer both in one answer. I think that when we are thinking about containers for projects, I've been working on this for like 4.5 years, maybe 5 years, there's already been different versions. It first started off as an open source, open access spreadsheet. Then it moved to the website. Then it has this publication. And then I even consider like this AR component to be another version of this project. People have asked, are you planning to do like an updated version in 2 years or et cetera? And I don't actually know if this is the goal because that we've designed the website in a way that hopefully will live on in perpetuity, we're hoping that will grow constantly. We almost take an oath of maintenance when we create projects like these because everyone wants to be the inventor, no one wants to be the maintainer, but that's actually a really important part of these types of works, and most works. But in terms of creating an updated printed version of the book, the reason why we made a print version to begin with was, one, yes, posterity, but also, I think when you're collecting these, when you're documenting these types of like grassroots activism, you almost need to infiltrate the resources of higher institutions to your advantage. And by printing an official version with an ISBN, I knew it would be included in the Library of Congress, so if for whatever reason the website was down, at least there would be some sort of a document. It feels kind of like an infiltration or a virus in that way, but it was important for us to have that clone. I would much rather make the print-on-demand version on the website way more robust, and we're trying to get a grant to do that because books and web are really complementary. CSS print can do a lot, print CSS. So we're hoping to just be able to style this so you can print out a spread and send this to Lulu or whatever print-on-demand printer and print out your own volume. So we want as many clones of snapshots as possible.
And it's so important that so many of the projects represented in the index have, you know, as you mentioned a little bit in your presentation, have not been able to be maintained or have been produced on platforms that have disappeared. And so, yeah, having this sort of way of archiving them that won't disappear and take up space in this way, I think is so important. Other questions? Oh, many other questions. Harrison in the back.
I really appreciate what you said about everyone likes being a dungeon, but it's unsexy and boring to be a maintainer. Maybe not boring, it's like, I have that wall and I think it's boring.
Yeah.
But it's very selfish. How are you thinking about like maintenance after you? Do you have some sort of idea about how you would like to handle that responsibility?
Yeah, so we have thought about this. I think that because we're partnered with Rhizome. Rhizome has this project they've been working on for a long time called Artbase. So with the Rhizome Commission, they basically said, we have to put this in Artbase. And I'm like, Thanks for offering. Like, we'll take that. ArtBase is basically an initiative to aggregate the metadata of artworks from multiple institutions into one database. So you can basically, if I search Sub Rosa and they have a work at MoMA, it will also appear in the Cyberfeminism Index. So you can pull all of that together, but then they have a system of web preservation in place because Dragon Espen Sheet is amazing. So that's, I think, our pretty solid backup plan. Yeah.
Thank you. Okay, we have time for two more, I think.
Yes.
Well, ever since the internet existed, it's always been a massive storage for all different kinds of content, and a lot of it is porn. As far as like the current moment with social media, there was sort of like nascent social media stuff in like early days of the web. Personally, I think who owns and monitors that should be really interesting. The fact that everything's like this rental model, and we don't own that medium in the same way is really, like, we don't own those servers and stuff. I don't know. Think about the feudal model, but also think about you can really endanger people's lives on the internet. Think about the Pegasus project and how journalists get chip chopped up because so.
Yeah, I mean, I think similar to what you're saying, sex workers are kind of like the canary in the coal mine because they push forward the development of new tech, but they don't get any credit for it. So OnlyFans is a great example of this. Sex workers built OnlyFans, now it's a household name. However, they were never really promoted on these other platforms. So when their new CEO came in, now it's promoted as a subscription-based content creation platform for cooking and other types of very PG content. So even if sex workers can use it, and even if they really built it up, they don't actually get any of the amplification from it. You see the same thing happening in crypto. You see the same thing happening with how they helped develop VR headsets, how they helped people who are using AI chatbots as their girlfriends, really helping with these LLMs. Like, it's really frustrating that a lot of this goes undocumented, but I do think oral histories are really important, and a lot of these people still talk about this quite actively. So like Hacking Hustling is a great collective. On the other side of this, I do think that I do observe a shift away from like this broadcast model towards these like smaller happenings. So broadcast is Instagram, which is basically dead, X, which is gonna die soon, TikTok, which is probably gonna die sooner. But you have things, people are building their own platforms. Like a lot of Gen Z people are using Geneva. I'm a daily Arena user. People are creating their own micro communities like Special Fish. I think it's cool right now to focus on talking to your friends online and not trying to just get a lot of followers. So I'm pretty, there's a lot of problems, but I'm also quite optimistic about a lot of the subcultural moments that I'm seeing.
It feels like people are moving toward intentional communities yes. rather than broadcasting.
Yeah, for sure.
Unfortunately, we have to go because of those long, thoughtful responses. Please join me in thanking our guests.